know, one of the things that makes Aspen so special is that in spite of all the glamour and the glitter, it still retains its old town charm. And one of the people who adds significantly to that charm is 79-year-old Francis Whitaker. He's one of America's finest blacksmiths. Our photographer, Tom Myers, went to his shop and saw him work on what he calls one of his most difficult pieces.
You either master the material or it masters you. I am a blacksmith for 64 years. Right now I'm working on a very elaborate and difficult balcony railing. If the eye cannot see it, the hand cannot make it. You have to be able to visualize what you're going to make and then make it. If you don't know what you're going to make, you can beat it around all day. It has to go quickly. I know of no slow way to do this work. I know of no easy way to do this work. Well, this one, the scrolls were shaped in one plane, and then they were bent into another plane, or a compound curve. And that is one of the most difficult things there is to do. I am solely responsible for what I do. The quality, I think, goes back in craftsmanship and in all crafts for centuries, and that is pride in workmanship. Build something that will last forever. It takes an irrevocable decision to do the best work you possibly can. To never short your job, never short your customer. I love it. I want to die with a hammer in my hand. This is an interesting set of fireplace tool handles. I have a number of different animal heads, and the client couldn't decide which one of half a dozen they would like, so we decided to make three different animal heads on a set of tools. It's been a very popular item ever since. Believe it or not, this was for a client in Ohio whose name is Charlie McCarthy. He had saved one of the old Charlie McCarthy spoons, brought it to me, and I transformed that into a set of fireplace tool handles. This is a very primitive figurehead. It looks, has a feeling of being African, forged out of 1¼ inches round. This was a set for a musician in the Aspen Music Festival. She wanted a lyre handle for the fireplace tools. This is one of the many varieties that you can do. They're almost endless. A twisted handle out of 6 pieces of 1/4 inch round on the left, a square stock decorated with a groovy tool on the left, set of andirons somewhere in Georgia with the animal head and the dragon wings. Note the offset log rest. This allows one to have the andirons far enough apart to put the wood between them and still rest on the log rest. A combination of brass and iron. This is one in California in one of the old Monterey homes. One of the many freestanding fireplace screens. This is in a home in Breckenridge. The entire frame was 6 feet wide. The two side panels were fixed with glass. The two center panels hinged. By the way, do not put the glass in yourself. Let the glass person do it. Then if anything happens to the glass, he's responsible, not you. One of the many freestanding fireplace hoods from someone who liked rectangular building blocks.
very difficult fireplace hood with the curved section and the curved top and bottom. An interesting set with a half-inch square handles wrapped around and the little fork pieces at the base of the each one of the tools. Set of candle holders that's in Hawaii with a bit of Aspen Mountain in the background. One of many pieces I made for a convent in Stockton. Very formal with brass, a mixture of brass and iron. The candle burners on the top are essential to keep the wax from flowing down on the candle. One of my favorites, a large 5 foot high candle holder that holds a 3 inch candle. This is more of the work for the convent in Stockton, California, the 7 branch candelabra and the large one with a 3 inch candle on the left. One I made for my son, it can be either hung from the ceiling, as is now shown, or the hook can be detached and used on the table for a table candlestick. One of many headboards, the brass ornaments in the center were made of 3 layers of 16 gauge brass, superimposed one on the other. Another candle, headboard, the client wanted the flora and fauna of the Rocky Mountains. So my late wife designed the bluebird and the magpie and the robin, and the leaves at the center at the top are brass aspen leaves. The oak leaves on either side are of copper, and down in the bottom the columbine leaves are made of aluminum. A sign for Leon Uris' residence in Aspen. A street sign for a condominium. The crossbars were fastened to the verticals with quarter inch round wrapped collars, about 6 wraps around. The wildest weather vane I ever made. The client sent me a photograph of his boat under full sail, and I translated that into a weather vane. House sign. Shadows are sometimes difficult when you're photographing ironwork, but I like the shadows in this one. One of the many door handles. The hole in the top is where the cylinder lock goes in. Hinges. This same idea came from the Albert Sun Early American Ironwork book. This is one of the many door handles I make. Again, the hole in the top right is for the cylinder lock. This is a set of hinges for a tack box in a stable somewhere back east. This is a pair of hinges and a door latch for a client in California. The holes were placed so they have a back plate matching on the other side, so they held all the boards in the gate together, bolted right through. This is a flower pot bracket holder. This is a part of a coat rack with, again, with the various animal heads. The shadows show them up better than the photograph. A hanging pot rack and dish cupboard. The trays were all hammered sheet copper. A gate with the typical lyre pattern that you see so much in the southern ironwork. A gate for a restaurant, the Golden Horn. The five horns on the balusters were made out of brass and silver soldered onto the uprights. A wine cellar gate. It was designed so the vertical bars came right up against the corks in the wine rack so the employees couldn't pull it out. A door grill in my own home in Aston. The center is a leaf columbine flower. I like the oval scrolls, and wherever I can, use the oval shape. A set of gates in California. This is a gate at Aspen. The spears on the top are forged out of 1.25 inches round. I had intended to forge them and then flatten them, but they look so interesting in the round that I left them that way. You notice that the spacing is unique, and in this case the left hand baluster vertical went right through the lockers. This is one of a series of window grills I made for the Santa Catalina School in Monterey. Interesting railing. This is out of 3/4 square. The balusters were all bolted into the big stair stringer. A little graveyard enclosure. In the background to the left, you can see some of the artifacts that I picked up around Aspen in the early days. A stair rail with that nice open pattern on the decorated elements. Another railing over in Breckenridge. I made a sample this piece and finally wound up with a couple hundred feet of that railing. One of my early pieces done in the 20s in Salinas, California. This is part of the most difficult job I ever did, that curved railing with all the scroll work bowed out. There's the whole thing. I still think in 70 years that is the most difficult piece I ever tackled. A shield for someone who liked to do fencing. A number sign for a residence out in the rural area. This was a ski rack set outside, and it would hold 9 pairs of skis. There's a close-up of, again, the three different heads. The Rocky Mountain ghost, the dog, and the ram. Chandelier with Mexican glass. I make lots of those chandeliers in different patterns. This was a replica of a Samuel Yellen grill. The grapes were all I made a die to forge the grapes, and they were all forge welded together. We're now in Charleston, South Carolina. If you have never been to Charleston, South Carolina, it's the greatest living museum of ornamental iron in this country. One of the stair rails. This series will all be in Charleston, South Carolina. Well, that's my late wife and aunt. I just put that in to show the scale of the buildings. This is one of the many, many intricate colonial balconies. The typical gate in Charleston. They use the lattice work in the bottom a great deal to keep dogs either in or out. Charleston in the spring is a beautiful sight with the azalea in bloom. The water lilies were used at the wave bars a great deal in the early Charleston work. Very simple window grill. This was my first experience in really seeing the heel bars or gates close up. Typical balcony in Charleston. This is the entrance gate to St. Michael's Church in Charleston. You see the lyre pattern was used a great deal. A nice touch on the finials on the top of this one. Also Charleston, the oval scrolls on the slanted part are one of the most difficult scrolls to make. But this is a very nice flow. Now let's go to New Zealand. This is Mr. McDonald, a blacksmith in Taupo, New Zealand. These are all in New Zealand. This shows the heavy door hardware. Most of these hinges were 3/8 thick. There were so many coats of paint, I could not tell just how they were made. A nice way to avoid a sloping rail. This was about a whole block long, and the ends on the, like on the right, were all stepped up. This is a door handle on a cathedral door in Dunedin, New Zealand. This is one of the many, many tie rods that were on the commercial buildings supporting a balcony that was over the sidewalk. It's so much rain there that almost all the sidewalks are covered with balconies, with overhanging balconies. There's another one. And none of the tie rods were the same. They had great many variations. There's the same building showing the old fire escapes, which you don't find anymore. This is a railing around a window well. And one of the things that was so dramatic about New Zealand ironwork is the lack of black. They were all colors of the rainbow. White, red, green, orange, yellow, you name it. There's a detail of the window well grating. One of the many tie rods with the decorative pattern in the center. This was in a charming little Victorian town in Timaru. No one had ever heard of it, but we decided to stop there to break up the train trip going south on the South Island. And it was really the most untouched, unspoiled Victorian city that we saw anywhere in New Zealand. This is on the old customs house. Detail of a entrance gate. This is one of the many gates in ironwork everywhere. This was the entrance to the facility on the dock in can't remember where. Very fine cast ironwork. This is in Wellington, New Zealand. Very fine cast ironwork. They had good Scotch blacksmiths, good coal, and good iron oil. And you could see the result. This is the gate to the entrance to the Wellington Yacht Club. A grill on the bank of New Zealand in Dunedin. Again, ironwork does not have to be black. This is the gate to the ferry that goes from the North Island in Wellington to the South Island in Picton. More at the Wellington Harbor. Another grill, again, on the Bank of New Zealand. So they didn't stick to one color. Another gate, this is to the harbor master. Hinges on a cathedral, again, these were out of 3/8 thick iron. I could not tell how they were made because of all the coats of paint. This is a hinge on a cathedral in Christchurch. Another gate in Christchurch. More of the elaborate hinges. This is one of the blacksmiths in Christchurch. This is a hotel where we stayed in Christchurch. Again, lots of iron balconies and fire escapes. This is the most interesting hinge on a door on the cathedral in Christchurch. I've never seen one like it. The bottom was a concealed pivot, and this long diagonal, the doors were about 12 feet high. There's the whole door assembly. Another set of hinges on the same cathedral around at the back entrance. This is the inside of the door, and something I had never seen before. When the door is open, there's a handrail on the door to hold, to support people when they walk down. This is the door pull on that same set of doors in Christchurch. Now, this is the Biltmore Mansion in North Carolina. One of the big lamps . This is the anvil in the Biltmore Mansion. We were privileged on the tour to go to places where the public could not go. There was a resident blacksmith when the Biltmore Mansion was being built, but somehow there's no record of his name and there's no record of who did the ironwork. This is a decorative work on an old chest. There was a lot of work done for the mansion, and there was a lot of imported work. This is part of a hanging chandelier. There's a detail of the connection of the chandelier. Set of fireplace tongs, 4 feet long. There was a fireplace in all 40 rooms. Part of a door grill with the nice quatrefoil pattern. A Spanish chest. There were about 30 lock plungers that went in all four directions, operated by one single key. There's a detail of all the lock plungers. There's another one. Very complicated mechanism. This is some of the Spanish woodwork and ironwork in large chests. One of the locks with the red velvet in back of the pierced plate. Another with the red velvet showing through. Typical Spanish Gothic work. There's the whole two doors together. Another different one. This the molding around a large fireplace. Bronze and Monel. This is the stair railing that goes from the library on the second story down to the main floor. Detail, and for the life of me, I could not figure out how that molded collar on the left was made. I examined it almost with a microscope, but I couldn't see how that was put together. There's the upper railing and the stairs coming down. That's looking down from the top. A decorative frame for a settee. A lot of this work was wrought iron and polished. Andirons for one of the big fireplaces. The heads were forged out of 4-inch square. There's a detail of a decorative leaf on the andiron. The decorative leaf and the animal head. Let's go to Finland. This is the famous Smiths in Finland. naked, swinging huge hammers right out in the public square. There's another view of them. This is one of the decorated gates in Helsinki. Another decorated gate, very elaborate pattern. This is in Stockholm, Sweden. And I was headed for a museum, and I was walking along the Strand, and I couldn't stop taking pictures of the door grills and the balconies. I never made it to the museum. An absolutely fabulous collection of wrought ironwork. Balconies everywhere. A hand rail on the inside of one of the hotels where we stayed. Another view of the same rail. Again, a detail of the railing. An entrance gate taken from the inside out. Door knocker with nice upset corners. Window grill. The Finns and the Swedes and the Norwegians didn't mind color in their ironwork either. Widow walk on the top of a building. An entrance gate to a courtyard. Another view looking through a window grill into the inside courtyard. This was the entrance to a museum. So many of the gates were recessed, I had to use flash, and unfortunately some of the hot spots show up. Another attractive window grill. This was a nice touch out in one of the public squares with Vulcan beating on the anvil. This was another very intricate pattern, entrance gate. Another view of the same gate. In all these pictures, the woodwork and the stonework were as wonderfully done as the ironwork. It was a great combination. These were pierced through on the diagonal. They used the wavy pattern on the top of the pickets a great deal. That's just an idea of the length of some of the balconies. This one was the full length of the building and about 50 feet long. one of the many ties on the brick buildings. The tie bar went clear through to the other side. There were a great many different patterns. Interesting door knocker. This was a guard on the corner of a building to keep the automobile from banging the corner of the stonework. One of the most elaborate door hinges that I saw anywhere. There's a close-up. Again, it was impossible to determine just how they were made with so many coats of paint. Door hardware on the same door. It looks as though it's a corner, but the woodwork paneling was on a 45 instead of horizontal and vertical. One of the entrance gates with a nice cresting. Look at the stonework, too, how beautifully that is done. Now, I think we're in Spain. The Spanish used a good deal of gold leaf, especially on their cresting. Now, this is back in Norway. Notice, which I had not seen before, the double rail with the pickets riveted in between instead of piercing the horizontal bar. Entrance to one of the many public buildings. One of the nicer door guards. Can't remember where that one was. Balcony, in this case, with a stone floor and stone braces. This was typical with the door window grills and the fan light above. Very interesting pattern, not symmetrical. I have difficulty because I want to make everything balanced. But there are so many of these curved balconies. This is in Bergen, Norway, with very decorated braces underneath, and the balconies themselves really bowed way out at the bottom. Strange to find the odd fellows. This is typical of the Scandinavian countries, with balconies and door grills and window grills everywhere. There's another one of the typical balconies. This was a real masterpiece. Curved and bowed out, and they used many large leaf patterns out of, looks like, about 3/16 material. Another series of balconies. And more balconies. handle, the animal head was forged out of 2-inch square. This was a different version, a very short, hardly a balcony rail, more like a planter box. This was taken from my hotel window in Bergen, Norway, typical widow's walk. Many, many fan lights of all different patterns. And another one. But again, the stonework was equally important and equally well done. This is one of the most elaborate ones that I found. Very intricate, very well done. I think this was a delivery entrance door, so they had that wire expanded mesh over it. You can tell from the heading where that's in Norway. And again, most of the balconies that I saw had a top rail, a secondary top rail, and then they were curved out. I found that the secondary top rail sets the pattern of your decorated part off much better than having it go right up to the top rail. This was a residence in Norway, and they didn't use the same pattern on the second floor as they did on the third floor. And again, all of these had such wonderful complementary stonework and woodwork. Another widow's walk. I came back from these trips to Europe and other parts of the world really and truly inspired to do nothing but the finest hand-forged ironwork without the use of the arc welder or the acetylene torch. And I hope that these slides will inspire you who see them to do the same thing. This is up the coast of Norway, a graveyard enclosure. This was the only contemporary ironwork that I saw that was worth recording. This is in Frogner Park in Bergen, Norway. Beautifully designed, lots of welding and lots of plasma cutting, but magnificently executed. There's another gate there. These are all in Frogner Park. The other modern, there's an example of the beautifully designed and executed contemporary work. There's a detail of that same gate. Whoever designed it had really great imagination, and whoever built it was a master craftsman. Lots of the stylized silhouettes and the Norwegians were not afraid of the naked human body. This is a huge fountain in Frogner Park with more than life-size cast bronze figures. I believe this is in Holland. I'll have to see how they go. No, this is still Norway. You see on the right corner how extremely bowed out that balcony is. And many times I used a very large leaf on the corner. Another one of the many building tires. Another one. This was way up the Norwegian coast, a huge outdoor lamp. And there's the base for it. And there's a detail of the central part of the lamp support. This was in Trondheim, Norway, in the Music Museum. The Music Museum had hundreds of different musical instruments from all over the world. This is a gate in the museum. This is one of the signs. You can see the little human figure on the right upper corner of the bracket. That one speaks for itself. The ironwork for the Historical Music Museum. Many, many different styles of balconies. And a nice combination there of ironwork and stonework and color. This is back in Bergen, Norway on the return trip. And again, this is a good example of the double horizontal rail with the verticals riveted in between. This one, I think it did not look like gold leaf. I think this one was bronze. An unusual one with stone corners instead of the wrought iron going around the corner. This is another widow's walk from my hotel window. This is around a museum. There must have been 500 feet of this railing. Another view of the rail. Now you can see at the bottom the double horizontal rail with the pickets in between. End view of the same railing. There, there's a better view of the double rail, the double horizontal. Very intricate door hardware. There's more of the railing. Another balcony with the concrete or stone corners. And you can see the large leaf patterns that they use. Another pair of building tires. And another of the many balconies. Interesting bracing at the corner of the deck. Speaking of balconies, on this trip, one of these trips, I went to Spain. In the public square in Salamanca, I could stand and count 400 different balconies around the public square. The designs, patterns are endless. And there again are the large leaf patterns. This was another example of a very heavy door hinges. This was the most interesting bracing I have ever seen on a balcony, coming from way up on the wall and curving down to the outer corner of the balcony. A door hinge in Bergen on one of the old Hanseatic wharf buildings. Nice old wrought iron anchor. I can't locate that one. I believe these were in the Basque Country in southern France. Yes. Yeah. That's where they were. Nice little railing around a statue on a church. Patterns are endless. Unusual door glass protector. Hardware on an old church. Again, they were not afraid of color or lack of color. Nice combination of door knocker and window grill. This is about as simple a window grill as you could have. There's no end to the patterns. This was in the Basque Country. A lot of, almost all the homes had shutters, and they were almost always closed. This pattern I had used once with the split off points. I had never seen it anywhere before, and here it was 3,000 miles from home. It was so interesting going to the different countries and see how the different patterns and styles had evolved. This is in, we're now in Spain. This railing was about 10 feet high.